colleagues there. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for having me here. Good afternoon. My presentation is about legal and tax consideration for midstream and downstream oil and gas investment in Myanmar. I have to say that I actually wrote it with foreign investors in mind. It was originally written for a presentation abroad. So it's a bit geared towards foreign investors, not so much towards local companies. But I think it can still be interesting because obviously, I mean, I'm trying to localize it a bit during the presentation. But the slides are unfortunately quite geared towards foreign investment only. So it's a very good time to invest in Myanmar. For about 2 years now, I think we've seen really a great deal of progress, a great deal of commitment. And that's not only good for foreign investors, obviously, but also for local investors. We have a national policy that encourages investment, not only foreign investment, as written on the slides, also local investment, obviously. And we have, fortunately, with the new Myanmar investment law that entered into effect in October last year, And with implementing rules and regulations that came into effect in the beginning, the new Myanmar investment law obviously didn't enter into effect last year, but already in October 2016, and the implementing rules and regulations came into force, beginning of 2017 till approximately April, and with that. We've seen a great liberalization in the oil and gas sector in that the joint venture requirements that existed so far with the Ministry of Electricity and Energy previously, if you wanted to do anything in the oil and gas sector, it had to be within a joint venture with the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. That was of course not so very good, and that wasn't really an encouragement for investment. But these joint venture requirements have disappeared. I'm still on this slide. You will see that there's a joint venture requirement for manufacturing and domestic distribution, but this is a joint venture requirement not with the Minister of Electricity and Energy. This is for a foreign investor wishing to engage in manufacturing and domestic distribution of certain oil and gas products. I'm not so sure if you could call it, but I understand what propane would be LPG. So in a very small area, we still have a joint venture requirement, but this is not with the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. This is with a local company, a local private company. So for the rest, as we can see here, for the rest, all these items that are here on this slide and the next two or three slides, they all require joint ventures with the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. This is gone. This has gone away. And what is still required is approval from the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. But this approval requirement was previously a means of actually keeping foreign investment out, because the ministry could always say, well, you know, we just don't want them here. But this has changed dramatically. This has absolutely changed dramatically. The policy at the moment is, if it's not explicitly prohibited, it's allowed. And we have no explicit prohibitions actually. So you will see the approval procedure is still a bit complicated maybe, but the market is open, the access restrictions have been removed, and it's now the time to take advantage of it. I have to say, if I compare the openness of the market in the oil and gas sector with countries in the region here, it's fairly open. It's in comparison that there are far less obstacles in Myanmar in terms of market access restrictions than we have in many countries in the region. So you see all of these you see all of these activities previously. You needed to conduct them in a joint venture with MOEE. Construction, installation of offshore platforms, import, especially import, export, transport, storage, distribution and sale of oil, gas and petroleum products. On a case-by-case basis, you could get a license if it was 100% locally owned company. But this wasn't the policy, and now it's an approval procedure. Approvals are granted on the basis of the merit of the investment to the country of what's submitted. But the share that the government wants in all of these investments is not there anymore, and that's a great improvement. So we have construction, operation of storage tanks, and so on and so on. Construction, operation of new refineries, upgrading and maintenance of existing refineries, exploration and interpretation of oil and gas. And the import-related things in connection therewith, then transportation and construction of a pipeline network. Again, no joint venture required anymore. It can be done 100% locally owned, 100% foreign owned. Joint venture in the private sector, but the government is out. So, okay, that was, I think, in the oil and gas sector, the most important bit of liberalization that we've seen. We have recently, you may have heard about it, this wholesale retail thing that was in the news pretty extensively. Whereby now foreigners are allowed to open retail shops and wholesale shops subject to certain capital requirements in case of retail, subject to minimum floor space requirements. On the whole, it's a very good sign. It's a sign that the government is honest with its promise of making the investment environment more hospitable to foreign investments. For oil and gas, however, this may not be too relevant, although other law firms say it, because for oil and gas things, you would need approval from the Ministry of Electricity and Energy, and we think that you would need additional approval from the Ministry of Commerce under the new notification, so it wouldn't be subject to the approval requirements under the new notification, although you would probably be doing quite a lot of wholesaling or retailing. If you, for instance, sell LPG or if you sell CNG, but that's a separate regime. The Ministry of Commerce they have confirmed that they aren't interested in regulating that. Although theoretically, it would be within the realm of that notification of the new notification 25 that came out in May this year. So, thirdly, the third item that I have here, which shows that the market is really opening up and that the legal framework is really being revamped in order to facilitate investment, is the new companies law that will now definitely enter into effect on the 1st of August this year. And very famously, it contains a clause that says, well, up to 35% foreign ownership in a company is harmless. It would still be a local company. So if it's up to 35% foreign owned, and this opens all sorts of opportunities. For instance, it would open the opportunity for a local company to take in a foreign investor with a minority shareholding, get investment, get money to increase the business, and still be subject to all the benefits that a local company has. That is, in particular, it's easy to get an import permit, it's land ownership. All these things should now be possible, even if there is a minority foreign shareholding in the company. That's another important item in the ongoing reforms. What we don't know yet, well, we know, for instance, from the Minister of Commerce, we know with the import thing. So as you probably know, so far, if you had a foreign shareholder in your company, it was always difficult registering the company as importer, exporter. And the Minister of Commerce, they have confirmed, yes, once the new company law is in effect from 1st of August on, we'll definitely treat a company registered under the new companies law with a minority foreign shareholding of up to 35%. We will treat this company as a local company, getting import-export registration will be almost automatic. What we don't know yet is if this also applies to land ownership. Theoretically, it should. Theoretically, it should be possible for a local company owning land to take in capital from abroad by offering minority shareholdings, but there we are not so sure yet if the land registration department would really follow the company's law and treat a company with minority shareholding, with a foreign minority shareholding as a local company. All right, so that was very broadly, the reforms that we've seen over the last 2 years, very encouraging actually. It's a very good time to be here and to invest. Now, for the investment procedure, the way to structure it, it's maybe not that oil and gas specific, but it always actually follows the same pattern. First of all, you have to find the land or the premises. If you're a local company, obviously you can buy them. You don't need to lease them. You can buy the land or you can buy the premises. If you are a foreign company, you're only allowed to lease. Because if it's an oil and gas investment, you would have to get approval from the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. And there, for a number of businesses, we now have quite specific criteria when these approvals are granted. The Ministry of Electricity and Energy has published this on DIPA's homepage. Unlike previously, when it wasn't very clear what you had to submit, it's now clear. You can check the list, you can go according to the list. Although this isn't true for all investments, but only for certain oil and gas related businesses, that the Ministry of Electricity and Energy has done this. Then, if you're a foreign investor company, maybe pretty soon, if it's a 35% minority foreign investment, then it's not necessary anymore. But at the moment, if it's a foreign investment and land is involved, the Myanmar Investment Commission has to be involved. The Myanmar Investment Commission can override the transfer of new properties restriction law that bars long-term leases for foreigners, and they can grant permission for a foreign investment company to lease land or remove property for 50 years. Renewal is possible twice for 10 years each time. Also, if you want tax incentives, both local company and foreign company, it's necessary to go to the MIC. Alternatively, you could invest in a special economic zone. They would also grant land use rights to foreign investment companies for 50 years, plus a prolongation of 25 years. And they also have specific tax incentives that are available to investors. You have to construct the facility, and then you have to unfortunately still go to quite a lot of ministries to get the required licenses in place. Oil and gas requires licenses from a number of ministries, and this is written down in the Petroleum and Petroleum Products Law. The Petroleum and Petroleum Products Law from 2017, 1st of August 2017, contains a list of ministries and a list of areas for which these ministries are responsible of giving out licenses, and you would have to consult in the first step the Petroleum and Petroleum Products Law, and then contact the ministries what you have to do in order to get the licenses, because unfortunately, it's still not a lot public. They're in the process of drafting rules, but a lot is not public yet. I mentioned already well MIC permit, MIC endorsement. If you are a foreigner and want to lease land long term, you have to go to the MIC. If you want tax incentives, irrespective of its if it's a foreign investment or a local investment, you have to go to the MIC. And another item of reform that was put into place with the new investment law that was enacted in October 2016. Is a simplified procedure for the MIC approval. Previously, we only had an MIC permit, which was very lengthy, very complicated to get, and now we have this MIC permit only for bigger investments. For investments that require a bigger amount of capital, rule of thumb is $20 million. For investments that require an environmental impact assessment or involve the use of state-owned land, for this we still have the investment permit. And for all other investments, it's the new endorsement procedure, which is much faster. And we had, I think yesterday or no, on Friday, we had the new chairman of the Myanmar Investment Commission talk to four chambers of industry and commerce, to four foreign chambers, and he promised, okay, this endorsement procedure, we're going to work on it and we're going to make it even faster, so that if the investment isn't too big, that it should be possible to actually get approval within weeks from the MIC. he said, yes, we know that this could be improved, and we will improve it, and we will make it much faster than it is now. So most likely we will see some market noticeable improvement there as well over the next few months. Okay, then we have in that list of steps, you know, the main steps that we have to go through when making investment. Yeah, well, oil and gas, everything basically requires approval from the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. And now, luckily, we have specific criteria for this approval. The Minister of Electricity and Energy has published a set of criteria on LIPA's homepage. For certain areas, not for every business in the oil and gas sector, but for some. And that's, of course, the installation of offshore supply bases, import, storage, and distribution of LPG, construction operation of refineries, LPG plants, fertilizer plants, petrochemical plants. It's not midstream and downstream, but exploration of oil and gas. They also have their set of criteria, installation operation of pipelines, import and installation of oil field testing equipment. This is what's there now. It's quite welcome because although obviously you would still have to work with the ministry. I mean, you can't just go by the list and submit. But it's very welcome that this has been made public. It's a way of getting to know things, pretty quickly, it serves as a very good overview. Then the petroleum and petroleum law, an important piece of legislation, obviously in this sector, but a piece of legislation that's very short. And for us, for the investment procedure, what's important is that it specifies which ministry is responsible for what, for which area of an oil and gas investment. So we've got the Ministry of Electricity and Energy. Is responsible for giving out licenses for the refinery, transit, transportation of pipelines, distribution, testing and analyzing. We've got the Ministry of Commerce that's responsible for giving out import and export licenses. We've got the Ministry of Transport and Communications that is responsible for licenses for motor vehicles, watercraft and barges, for the carriage of petroleum and petroleum products. And we've got the Department of Mines under the Ministry of Natural Resources and Environmental Conservation that's responsible for storage licenses, for warehouse and storage tanks, for storage licenses, for warehouse and storage tanks, for transportation permits for motor vehicles, watercraft and barges for the transport of petroleum and petroleum products. This is the Ministry of Mines, for instance. The Department of Mines has already a set of procedures for these licenses. These procedures were devised under the old petroleum rules from 1937. There are several licenses for underground tanks, above ground tanks, for non-dangerous petroleum, for hazardous petroleum. Likewise, the Ministry of Electricity and Energy, they have already procedures in place devised under previous legislation. But still, a lot of these licenses, I mean, the framework is about to be reformed at the moment, and it's necessary, it's still necessary, because so very little is public actually. It's necessary to go to the ministry and inquire with the ministry what is actually required. It's necessary to go not only to one ministry, to the Ministry of Electricity and Energy, it's necessary to go to four ministries. And inquire what licenses are actually required. The implementing rules of the petroleum and petroleum products law are apparently being drafted at the moment. They will contain information as to the license types, requirements for application, and authority of the four ministries involved. Special rules for LPG, LNG, and CNG business apparently, but the rules aren't out yet. They're in the process of being drafted. So for the time being, this licensing procedure is still a bit opaque, and it's quite difficult actually to research it online. It's necessary to go to the ministry and speak with them. Alright, last two or three slides, the tax considerations. Well, yes, hopefully you will be profitable, so you will also be subject to tax. And we've got Myanmar isn't a low tax country, but it's also not a specifically high tax country. 25% actually is quite high. But we've got, in any case, corporate income tax of 25%. We had recently, on Thursday last week, or on Wednesday or Thursday last week, we had a very welcome announcement or very welcome notification from the Ministry of Planning and Finance, from the Internal Revenue Department. And according to this notification, the withholding tax on domestic service fees is largely abolished. If you pay a foreign service provider, you still have to withhold 2.5% from the invoice, but the service fee, withholding tax on service fee and on the domestic production of goods, which previously was 2%, is abolished if you buy from the private sector. Okay. Then there's tax on salary from 0 to 25%. There's capital gains tax. Midstream, downstream is 10%. Upstream is 40 to 45%. We have commercial tax, VAT in other countries, usually 5%. A few services are exempt, such as transport services. Then, like VAT in other countries, there's the possibility to set it off, to set off the input tax with the output tax. We've got special goods tax on certain petroleum products. Yeah, and then we have customs duty and stamp duty. The tax incentives, that's the last slide. Unfortunately, in the oil and gas sector, tax incentives aren't really available that much. We have, in promoted sectors, we have corporate income tax exemption under an MIC permit for 3, 5, or 7 years, but only in promoted sectors. And quite a lot in the oil and gas business isn't promoted. So this corporate income tax exemption in many cases wouldn't actually be available that would otherwise get with an MIC permit. But obviously the exemption on the import of construction materials and on machinery and equipment during the construction period is still there, and that's quite a valuable exemption, and for this alone, it's worth going through the MIC procedure. Lastly, if you invest in an SIZ, there are specific tax incentives in an SIZ, but I think we leave it here. it's now it's a bit too detailed. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. That was my presentation. A bit high level, I know, not very detailed, but it was actually written for foreign investors that that have to be convinced to come here and spend their money. You know the rules already, so it's not necessary to convince you, but the ultimate goal of that presentation was to convince the few foreign investors here to stay here and spend their money. Thank you very much.